All right, so the topic for tonight, did God forsake Jesus on the cross? Now, this has been very controversial through the years, particularly because it is at the heart of Christian, of traditional Western Christianity. So we're just going to go through and understand it a little bit first, and then I got both sides of the fence here, so to speak, and then we can just kind of conclude with the message that coincides with Jesus' teachings in the Gospels. Okay. So the scriptures that refer to this are they are in Matthew and Mark. And so Matthew 27:46 says, from the Lamsa translation, and about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice and said, "El, el, lama sabachthani? My God, for this was I spared, for this was my destiny." Okay, now we go to the King James, which is the original and the traditional even now. And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice, saying, "El, el, lama sabachthani?" That is to say, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?" All right, and it is in Mark. I'm not going to go ahead and read it because it's the same thing as Matthew. But the difference, notice the difference. There's two differences here. For this I was spared. And then in the King James, it has Jesus saying, asking God why he has forsaken him. Now, and also another difference is you'll notice there's an exclamation point here. I have it in red in the Lamsa version, and in the King James version it is a it's a question mark. All right, now let's look at oops. Hold on a minute, folks. Oh, okay. I just have them out of order. So if we go to the Aramaic, all right, there is a translation difference, which is part of the reason that it is so contradictory. So, and I have the Aramaic words up here. And just real quickly, okay, it's my God, all right. Now, whenever you see L, or there's different dialects of Aramaic that come into play, but basically, L means God, okay, and whenever you see it in combination with some other letters, you always know that it means part of that, whatever it is. It could be a name, it could be Bethel, I believe, is the town of God. So anyway, that's and but in that's Western Aramaic, and it's also the Hebrew, because the name for God in Hebrew is Elohim. But the other Eastern Aramaic, it's not exactly El, it's Al, Alaha. So anyway, so that's all clear. There's no difference there really. And the I on the end of when it says El and then it has I, In Aramaic, that means with the I on it, that means my God. Okay. And so the word lemana means for a purpose. And well, I didn't type this in here. Okay. But this word that I'm pointing here is shvatan, shvatani. They say it sabachthani, with whichever, it doesn't matter. And that's where, remember, Aramaic words have more than one meaning because there weren't that many words. And so that word could mean keep, reserve, spare, or give. So one more time, when the Greeks were translating from the, well, it's the Greeks and the, well, it went into Latin too. When they were translating, they found, okay, the that word means forgive, and that's the way they translated it. Now, the problem with many of the translations in the Bible is that, and when scholars are translating, they don't look at the whole picture. They don't look at the, and many times they don't know the context. And so we came up with forgive. My God, why? I'm sorry. Let me go back. My mind's not real good. Okay. Yeah. My God, for this I was spared. But then we have, my God, why hast thou forsaken? So basically, from Aramaic, that's in the translation, that's where it comes from. However, now we're going to try and answer that question. Did God forsake Jesus on the cross? And first, we're going to do yes, okay? Because that is the traditional Christian viewpoint. And so traditional Christianity, and these quotes right here are these are from Billy Graham. And this is kind of the heart and soul of the Christian theology, and why they say yes, that God forsook Jesus on the cross. So they say, and this is Billy Graham, traditional Christianity, Jesus is actually quoting the opening line of Psalm 22 and using it to express his deep agony on the cross. He is suffering the penalty for our sin in our place. Well, just remember, this isn't our approach. This is the traditional. The penalty for sin is death, and death includes two dimensions, physical and spiritual. Physical death is the separation of the spirit from the body, which we would agree. Spiritual death is the separation of the spirit from God. Since Jesus was dying for our sin as our substitute, he was experiencing the agony of separation from his Father. It was the agony of hell. Okay, and remember, at that point in time, when Jesus was on the cross, there weren't no hell. Hell came about later. So, all right, that's the yes. Now, we go to no. All right, and we just talked about that. So, from the Lhasa translation, from the Aramaic translation, the answer clearly is no. God did not forsake Jesus on the cross. And here's why. Noticed, and I pointed out that the traditional quotation has a question mark, okay? And it's a question, my God, why have you forsaken me? The Lhasa translation has an exclamation point. It is an exclamation there. So we have to ask, okay, why would Jesus ask his father, why would he question his father when he had already accepted his destiny? And so we go to Matthew 26:39. At that point in time, I mean, Jesus had a deep knowledge of his reason for living and dying. And I'm just going back to Matthew 26:39, where Jesus was praying and conversing with God. Okay. So 26:39. Okay. And he went a little further and fell on his face and prayed, saying, "Oh, my Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. But let it be not as I will, but as thou wilt." Now, Jesus didn't want to do this. Okay. I mean, his humanity, I mean, he didn't really want to do this, but he prayed. He asked his father, God. And then the second time he said, he went away again the second time and prayed and said, "Oh, my father, if this cup cannot pass, and if I must drink it, let it be according to thy will." Now, does this sound like Jesus is going to then turn around on the cross and say, "Oh my God, why have you forsaken me?" Just a thought. Okay. In his prayer in the garden, Jesus had overcome all his adverse bodily feelings and left the outcome to his father. Okay. So he wasn't questioning his father at all, right? And his cry was a victorious one. You know, God did not abandon him. God, well, hold on. All right. Now, another reason for perhaps for the misunderstanding was because of Jesus was Galilean, okay? And that meant that he spoke a slightly different dialect than what many of the people there were. And they and this was the Hebrews in it, the Hebrews, the Jewish people there did not did not understand, and they thought that Jesus was calling for Elijah. Okay, now we have that verse here. Some of the men who were standing by, when they heard it, said, "This man has called for Elijah." Well, that was part of the Old Testament, the Torah, and it was a belief of the Hebrews that they would sometimes say that prayer when death was apparent. But that was not the case, and that is not what the people, the Galilean people, which of course were mostly Jesus' mother and disciple John and whatnot, that's not the way they understood it. And of course, so the Roman soldiers, they didn't really have a clue what Jesus was saying. And so So there was confusion there as to what he said. And then of course, you have the Isaiah chapter 53, and I didn't put it in here. You can read it if you want to, but that's the called the suffering servant, which they say Jesus fulfilled that prophecy from Isaiah. So there's all kinds of things that they say was that's supporting or not supporting what Jesus said. But the Galileans who were present knew he meant that his destiny was fulfilled because they understood the language. Okay, so we are continuing to answer the question, no, Jesus did not, I mean, God did not forsake Jesus on the cross. All right. Now, let's go to Psalm 22:1. Now, some people, well, and you heard that Billy Graham said, well, Jesus was just repeating this from Psalm 22:1. Well, once again, okay, we have the Lamsa version, which is, my God, why hast thou let me to live? And yet thou hast delayed my salvation from me because of the words of my folly. Okay, and then the King James version once again says, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Well, the phrase is the same. And from Psalm 22:1 and to Matthew 27:46, the phrase is the same. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? And of course, Dr. Lones says it slightly different, but it's the same situation. Why have you let me to live? But you have to remember, this is a psalm of David, and in it, and the what he's saying is about Israel, okay? And Israel is saying, why have you let me live, and why have you made us go through this and delayed getting our salvation? So evidently from Psalm 22, and that's where that word was taken again from spared or forsaken. And so evidently they took the translation from Psalm 22 and said, okay, that's what Jesus was saying. Well, and see, that's what, that's the problem with theology. No matter what theology it is, whether it's a denomination, whether it's whatever, but they pick these things out, and then they develop all the other stuff around them. And in this case, traditionally, it's all about sin. Okay, it's all about Jesus took the sins, took on the sins of all mankind. He died for the sins of all mankind. That's the Christian. That's the heart of the Christian theory. But now, and the reason, okay, the reason that God, the reason they say that God forsook Jesus is because Jesus took on sin, and God could not look at sin. Okay, now just don't the this is what the theology is, and I tried to logic out the okay, God couldn't look on Jesus' sin then because Jesus took on the sins. And of course, I tried to logic stuff out. Well, what about, did Jesus took on the sin then? Well, then, but the other, and in the other last sayings, Jesus commended his spirit to God. So, and what I learned, and I even asked Dr. Errico, is that there's no, you can't logic the theology, you can't logic, if you think logically, you just can't do it. And again, this was a translation, and the scholars didn't know. They really didn't know anything about the context. They had this sentence and they had this word and they said, okay, forsake. But they didn't know the context, okay? And that's where Dr. Lamsa comes in. And Dr. Lamsa lived all of this. He lived it, okay? He spoke Aramaic. It was his native language. And he knew the context, and he knew that that word should be spared and not forsaken. And so I, I have to say I am biased. Yes, I am, because that's what we teach is Dr. Lamsa's teachings. But he is the only person. The only man that really, even till today, that is really capable of translating the whole Bible based on his cultural background and his language. So I just had to put that in there because people, people say, well, where do you get it? Where's your proof? Well, there's no proof in the Bible because no one really knows exactly what happened, but that's where we come from. Dr. Lunson knew the culture, he knew the language, and he could apply it. Okay. So now we just look at this, just, well, I don't want to use the word logically, but all right, we have learned through Jesus' teachings that God is always with us. Remember, he said, God is near. That was all part of his teachings. All right. And that God is a loving father. And God is spirit. God is always there, always with us. And God doesn't move, okay? He's there. He doesn't move. He doesn't change. We change. And so there's when Billy Graham said, well, there's spiritual death, you cannot be separated from God. Okay, so that's just a difference. I'm not being critical, but based on Jesus' teachings, there's no such thing as spiritual death. And you cannot be separated from God. It doesn't matter if you're a killer, if you are whatever, however heinous you may thing you may have done, it doesn't matter. God is still there. And we don't jump in and out of God, God's just there waiting. And if you are one of these heinous people, one of these, oh, which of course, going along with that Jesus died for our sins and that theology, we have guilt, okay? Because we need to have some guilt because we're all sinners and that we, and Jesus died for our sins and we should have some. But no, God. Even if you're it doesn't matter, criminal, whatever, all you got to do is turn to God. How you turn to God? You just turn your mind and talk to God, whatever. And that's it. And see what theology does, what Christian theology has done. Okay, with this spiritual death kind of thing, all right, they have put, I call them, well, let's call them bumps in the road. It's maybe not fair to call them roadblocks, but basically it is. But they have put conditions when they say, okay, there's a spiritual death, you're separated from God. Well, then theology, and it's different for different denominations, have all these things that you need to do to get back with God. And it's just no, nothing can separate us from God. And for answering that question, did God forsake Jesus? And the question we saw with the prayers that he had, that he knew, and he knew what was going on. And Jesus was always in one accord with his Father. We talked about that when we talked about the teachings. Jesus always, when he got in a spot, and he did get in spots because he was human, he just went off and he prayed, and he talked to God, and he got things worked out. So, and I wanted to focus on this because it's like, okay, we talked about the Aramaic translation, and this is how it occurred, and that's what scholars do, but it has an effect. It has an effect on people, because of the differences, and it's just the way that those theologies develop. But I will say, Jesus did not die for our sins. Okay. Now in Aramaic, I don't have that screen up, but in Aramaic, Jesus died because of the sins of mankind. And that of course contradicts the Christian theory of Jesus died for our sins. But there's many people, not just us and not just Dr. Lomsa, but many people are beginning to question that. Many people have suffered greatly trying to figure this out. And I mean, it has literally affected, I know a couple of people that have breakdowns over it because they just couldn't understand. And then they heard, they thought about it, and they heard about it, and it's all this stuff. It's just the Bible was written by God, and everything in the Bible, is the inerrant word of God. Well, if you even a little bit look at the Bible and think about it, causes problems. So anyway, during his ministry, Jesus had declared and taught that God was a loving father who was aware even when a sparrow falls. He always felt God was with him. Even when he spoke of his death, he predicted his disciples would forsake him, but his Father would always be with him. And I'm going to qualify that and say, when people read the Bible, typically they don't read it for understanding. And many people focus on Jesus, and I have no problem with that. Jesus is my hero, but not because he died for my sins. Okay. He I'm losing my train of thought, sorry. But anyway, His father was always with him. Oh, my point is that God is always with us too. People think that they focus on Jesus, and it doesn't occur to them, it would if they read the Gospels, doesn't occur to them that God is with them too. And that all they need to do, all we need to do is just turn to God. Because remember, repent, it doesn't mean that you have to, get down on your knees or da 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 da, do all that. No, it just means you turn to God. There's no bumps there that you got to do in the road that you got to, or hurdles that you got to go over in order to get back to God. No, because remember Jesus. Jesus forgave the criminal on his left. He didn't say, well, you have to do this, you have to do that, and then you'll be forgiven and whatnot. No, it's instantaneous, because that man, his heart was in the right place when he talked about the Jesus and who he was and whatnot. And so he was forgiven. And so anyway, I just hope that maybe that's what we can get out of this tonight, instead of just the scholarly stuff about, well, no, God didn't forgive him. So, okay, now, so just one last thing, I think. Oh, you know what? I left this in here if you weren't here last week, because I've always found this fascinating, and I did, and I have asked, and you can find it. You have to look very carefully, because most people don't. Well, obviously Christianity is going to have Jesus with the loincloth and whatnot, but actually, Jesus was crucified with his garments on. The reason being, okay, once again, now remember, the Christian Bible, Western Christianity, so to speak, it does come from Greek, but not originally. Okay, and so they follow all the Roman, the Greek things, and the Romans, I'm sure they did crucify people, some maybe even without a loincloth, but the reason that Jesus had garments on is because of the nudity laws in Jewish Jewish and the Muslim faith today. Nudity is a big no, and that for people watching the crucifixions, there were women and children. So anyway, I found this picture. It's the only one that I could ever find, obviously, but I left it in there and just thought that would be interesting. Okay. All right. So to wrap it up, because the cross takes on a different meaning when we study it. So the symbol of the cross, that had always been the symbol of finality and total annihilation, was to become the symbol of life and glory. This cross was to be known as the way of enlightenment and non-violent way of life. Jesus' teaching brought him to the cross. That's a pretty strong statement, but it's true. All his teachings brought him to the cross, because he taught eternal life, and he tried to, and remember, Jesus' message was spiritual. So, that's what he taught, but it's difficult to teach spiritual, non-tangible things, but that's what his teachings were all about. And that's why he had to die on the cross. And he had impressed on the minds of his disciples the fact that death would not be the end of his mission, but the beginning of a new spiritual era, the inauguration of the kingdom of heaven on earth. Okay, now I want to say one thing about this. The idea here of a new spiritual era. There was, because I'm based on where I'm at and where we're at in the Western Christian world, I sometimes just have to say, I don't know. It's maybe it. I don't want to say that Jesus' mission failed, but we don't even like to talk about the spiritual side of things, basically. But this is historically documented, because I've been reading this book. In the first couple centuries, this idea, this new spiritual era, where there was lots of healing and nonviolence and whatnot, it did happen in the first couple of centuries. And it spread, but it did not spread to the West. It spread out through Asia and China and whatever. And so it was there. And I like to understand that, because in our world today, this idea of spiritual and whatnot, it's just kind of cloudy. And so Jesus showed us through the cross, okay, and the resurrection, that we don't die. Okay. I think I had the Ecclesiastes 12:7 last week. You know, our bodies, our physical bodies, wear out and they return to dust. But our spirit always goes to God. And Jesus, of course, said that on the cross. I commend my spirit to you. Okay, so that is it. I really don't, let's see. Okay, well, I'll just say, like I usually do, we appreciate contributions. It really does help us do some things. And we will, after we take a break, not tonight, but we have another one of Dr. Lanza's books ready that we have published, and so we'll have them out there soon. All right. Now, the other thing I wanted to say is, okay, I'm going to do spring break, and I hope that you all, I'm going to take two Mondays off. I'm weary, and I need to just chill for a little bit and work on, and we're going to have a little slightly different Bible study, but it will be interesting. So so for the next two Mondays, I'm going to take off, and I will send them I will send an email out so that people know. But I do thank you for your contributions and for your participation. You know, we record these and people can go and watch the videos, because and that's okay. But I need a few people here to keep me to keep me inspired, and so I appreciate that. And so we're going to wrap up for tonight. And so I will just say happy Easter. And
thank you. Happy Easter to you.
Celebrate Jesus however you want to celebrate, whatever, you know, but celebrate life, eternal life, because we all, you know, we all have it, really. And, you know, forget about the stumbling blocks and stuff and just celebrate. And maybe get some jelly beans or something.